So let me go to you first, Teodoro, since you need to hit the road. I want to just, since you've not been with us before, and I really welcome you that we have a new face here on this vigil, which we hold every Friday evening. What is it about WikiLeaks and Julian Assange that that's most important to you, and why do you think it's important for you to take part?
So the very reason that my family came to America and left Ethiopia was because of government tyranny. And in Ethiopia in 1974, the communist or the Derg government took over and unleashed hell on Ethiopians. And so I know very well, it's an intimate thing. That's something I know intimately in terms of what it's like to be repressed by a government. And so we came to America because it was a land of freedom. And I'm thankful to America for that. But at the same token, none of us could sit down and remain silent just because we have a modicum of freedom and see other people far away or people that might not necessarily be right next to us feeling the heat of oppression, the same oppression that induced me to leave Ethiopia and come here to America to begin with. We should all speak up because as is done to somebody else, we open up the pathway to be done to us. So that's why I speak up. Also, as a fellow journalist and somebody that's involved in the media, free press is something that I care about deeply, as most all of us do. And even up until recently in Ethiopia and throughout a lot of countries within Africa, journalists were targeted viciously and continue to be targeted viciously throughout most of the world. To do this to somebody just because he was doing his job, most of the world. And exposing the malfeasance and corruption of people in power and effectively lock him up against his will for all this time, it's unconscionable. So we have to speak up, and that's why I'm speaking up.
And tell me a little bit about the publication you started and what is its purpose?
Sure. So the Gion Journal was started 2 years ago. After going through a stretch of tribulation, I kind of saw how people at the bottom of society, the invisible faces that get put to the side, and I realized that it's not about the various constructs that divide humanity. It's really the powerful versus the powerless. And so the Gion Journal was started for a lot of reasons, but one of it is to kind of speak against the divisions that induces tribalism, that keeps us at each other. And the other part of it is to kind of speak up against power and try to seek truth. Not necessarily, you know, thinking that we have ownership of it. Nobody knows really what the objective truth is, but at least we try to seek it. And part of that is to speak against the media narratives that are being spun up on purpose to incite emotions and to antagonize us. And so we try to do the opposite. We don't speak into the divides. We try to bridge people and have rational conversations instead.
Now, why do you think that the American public and average people around the world are not demanding that Assange be allowed to do his work and be free, because they are the ones who benefit from it?
I think we've been conditioned over successive decades and generations of, which has reached a fever pitch now, of just accepting. So when it's one outrage after the other, you kind of get inured to it and you don't really pay attention to what's going on anymore. So, you know, led by a chorus of mainstream propagandists, they've kind of successfully programmed us to look at injustice as a hashtag and not necessarily as something that we should all care about. So something comes up, we get outraged, 24 hours passes, a new cycle passes, and then we forget about it. And we've reached a derangement level with the Trump administration now, because everything's an outrage. What he says is an outrage. This afternoon, Whitaker was on you know, giving his testimony and the whole bread and circus of it all.
He's the Attorney General nominee.
Correct. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Correct. And so, you know, this is why, by the way, what Julian Assange did was such a threat, because instead of partaking in that carnival, he was actually doing the job of a journalist, which is exposing corruption and malfeasance. This is what journalism is supposed to be about. It's not recording what somebody else says and just pass it along. It's not echoing the authorities in government. Is to question them. That's why the founders of America and the rights of free speech were enshrined in the Constitution, because some of the founders, anyways, realized that the only thing that the last line of defense between freedom and tyranny is a really a truly free press. And so that's why it's in the Constitution. That's why journalists have such esteem within the broader public. And unfortunately, mainstream media, the model of monetizing outrage and monetizing sensationalism, we've actually devolved in ways that the young journalist of William Randolph Hearst tells them to comparison compared to what MSNBC, CNN, and Fox News and their kind are doing. And so here comes along Julian Assange doing the job of a macro anchor, and he's catching the brunt of it. And it's a, you know, that's the outrage. But again, we're so focused on the outrage of politicians pretending like they're fighting each other that we're looking past the things that we should really be paying attention to.
And you've just brought up what I was going to mention, which is this phony partisanship. You wrote a piece, you allowed us to republish an excellent article you wrote we republished in Conservative News on Malcolm, when Malcolm X said back in the 60s, that rings so true today about African-American political leaders, in particular someone like Kamala Harris and also Barack Obama, as you pointed out. And in those days when the when Obama was in power, WikiLeaks revealed crimes of the Bush administration, or when Bush was in power, that was heralded by a Democrat or a liberal press. Mm. Now that he's revealed some of the shortcomings, to put it mildly, of Hillary Clinton, they hate his guts and they want him out. So talk to me a little bit about the role of partisanship. How phony is it and how real is it? Because it is quite heightened right now in Washington, I could tell you that.
So it's phony within the establishment. They all know it's a game. I've been to, if you're ever in D.C., there's a bar or a restaurant. I can never go there now. But there's a restaurant called Old Devil's Grill. And this is where it's like the watering hole of the political establishment. And the news reporters go there, and a lot of Congress people go there as well. You'll see them. I remember the first time I actually saw this, it shocked me. I didn't realize exactly what I saw until later on when I was looking back in reflection. But I saw like crossfire on CNN, and there was two Congress people. I can't really recall exactly who it was. And it was left versus right. They were just yelling at each other, frothing at their mouth, and just you would have thought they were about to get up and punch each other. So later on that day, that evening, I was in D.C., so I stopped by after finishing up school and stopped by Old Devil's Grill. I was like, let me see what this is about. So I walk inside there, and there they are right there, the same people I saw on CNN, almost declaring a holy war on each other, like hanging out and laughing together. And so I didn't realize it at that time, but I see it now for what it is. It's a joke to them. It's a reality show that it's like that during the Roman Empire, they had bread and circus to keep the public distracted. And so that's what we have. But it's a deadly serious thing for the rest of for society because we believe it. We keep inhaling this toxic partisanship. And as a consequence of it, society gets fractured into ghettoized. And we fight each other while the powers that be are enjoying the fruits of our labor while we are left with nothing but seeds. And so this is, in a lot of ways, this is what Julian Assange was exposing, not just with what happened with the DNC server, but there was a lot of the cable gate and a lot of other things that he exposed where he was showing the dog and pony show of not just American politics, but even a geopolitical level. And that is why he's a threat to the establishment and why we should defend him, because he's in a lot of ways what he's doing is vital to, not national security, but humanity security, because the reason why these wars keep getting started, the reason why economic inequalities are destroying the lives of millions, if not billions around the world, is because of policies that, nefarious and malicious policies. And that's what he was doing and WikiLeaks is doing. And that's why they're hated, because the establishment press, the corporate press, is under the same dole as the politicians. They all work and they're all under the thumbs of corporations and the oligarchy. And so it's up to us to rally behind it, because in a lot of ways, the Guillaume Journal is following the same model as the WikiLeaks. Not in terms of what, exposing the things that they're doing, because we don't have that capacity, but in terms of being funded by readers and the audience, being disavowing corporate contributions. This is the model that I really believe can work. And when you do that, you take away the power of the patrons of corporate media. So that's why corporate media is upset, and that's why corporate politicians are upset. And so it's up to us, the people, because the true enemy of the ones that feel the heat the most from all these corporate friendly politicians and corporate friendly pundits and mainstream journalists are us. We get distracted and then we eventually get the short end of the stick. So it's important that we pay attention, because ultimately we're going to pay the price for it.